So, this is an unusual video. We're going to come up to the current state of affairs and help out a bit. I can help out a little bit. I can't explain everything, or maybe even anything, but I can add a little bit of knowledge. So, on Blanco Lirio's channel, he has put a video up about a GE90-115B having a problem with an interstage seal. This caused events that led to the turbine to fail. The turbine disc, I'm pretty sure. Maybe it was just a couple of blades, but I'm not sure. The details of the accident are not really, they're not out there. There's an emergency airworthiness directive that I've read, and it doesn't contain a great deal of specific information, but I'm going to add my little bit of what I can contribute to the knowledge base to help people understand better what's going on. So we don't work on engines that new. We work on old stuff, and I'll show you the differences. But like I'm often fond of saying, they're all different and they're all the same. So I found it interesting that in the airworthiness directive there are eight actual parts in question. It's not the engine, it's the part. And so they're listed by part number and then eight individual serial numbers, which I found strange because the numbers are all different. And a serial number, it should be a series of numbers or numbers in serial, like 123, 124, 125, blah, blah. All these numbers are large, alphanumeric, and quite different. That's strange to me, but hey, part numbers are a black magic all to their own. So what I'm going to do is talk about how an interstage seal could cause a turbine blade or disc to fail, and we're going to show you what an interstage seal is. All right, let's change the camera angle. Okay, this is the normal sort of turbine disc that we work on. This is a third stage disc from a J79, and it is very heavy, solid all the way through. You can see that there's no passages through it. It's heavy metal. And this is one of the blades from this particular stage. They go in pairs, and you can see that it matches up quite nicely with its partner, I suppose. It's matching. This would be called a trailing blade, because it's, if the turbine turns this way, which it does, this would be the second of the pair to encounter a counter as it went by a counting point. The leading edge one would be here, and its little teeth are on the other side of the root. So these blades are uncooled. There's no air passages around them or through them. There's no air exit points. Look at that. Okay, that's an old engine. A newer engine would be the CF6. So the CF6 is a generation, maybe two generations older than the GE90, but the GE90 is developed from the CF6 because very, very rarely does a completely new clean sheet of paper design come out, because that costs billions, actually tens of billions of dollars. Tens of thousands of millions of dollars to develop a completely new engine. So it's very rare. Just like the Trent is a development of the RB211. The RB211 was a completely clean sheet, new design, and it nearly bankrupted. It did bankrupt Rolls-Royce, and then they got back on their feet again, and it's all great, and they're back and everything. Anyway, a completely new engine nowadays would likely require the resources of several manufacturers working together. So it's extremely expensive, and that's why it's better to massively massage and revamp the design of an existing highly successful engine like the CF6. Anyway, the CF6 does have air-cooled blades, and we're going to take a look at a couple of those right now. Hang on. Okay, hiding back behind our turbine, next to our diagram of an RB211, we actually have a high-pressure turbine blade that had a bad day, a rub, and was worn away. A very bad incident, but this is from an F404, an engine from the FA18. Pretty cool. You can see there's air passage entries in the base. And this is supposed to have a controlled leakage pathway, not a completely open top. It's supposed to look more like this one. So you've got controlled leakage through there. Can you see the front? Yeah, you can see that. That's for film cooling. Look at that. This is the pressure side of the blade, so the hot gases are going to hit this, and out of these holes is leaking compressor discharge air. We're going to get to how that happens in a minute. Okay, and this is the model I built. It's not a model, it's an actual blade that I very carefully sanded away the metal. This took hours to do. And this blade is featured in my video called Air-Cooled Blades, which I recommend that you watch. You'll love it. Anyway, this has another companion blade, just like this guy. And it forms, you can see the marks of the companion blade that made the, it has the cutouts in its side and it allows the air to leak into there. So that's why this is flat. The other one contains the air passage entryways. I don't have a matching pair because, well, it's hard to come by these things. They're very expensive. They're several thousand dollars a piece. Anyway, this was a scrap one that I cut apart. Okay, now where was I? Now, quite a few people asked when I made this video years ago about the air-cooled blades. They asked me, how does the air get to there? How does it get there? We showed you the solid turbine blade, or we showed you the solid turbine disc. How does the air get there? Well, the reason I haven't shown the air passageway in the engine to get the cooling air to here is because in a way there is no passage. There's a passage in a sense that there's a hallway has got a wall on one side, a wall on the other, and a roof and a floor, but the actual space you walk through is just empty space. If you want to think about it, there is no hallway in your house. There's a wall, another wall, a roof or a ceiling, and a floor. And you go through the empty space, if you think about it that way. So there is no part that is the cooling air duct for the turbine blades. Just like, and I love this, there are no fuel tanks in airliners. Yeah, I said that. There's a space in the wings that's sealed up with sealant, and the outer skin of the wing contains the fuel. And there's bulkheads that partition off areas of volumes, areas we call them, but they're volumes of the wing that act as fuel tanks because there is no part number for a fuel tank. If you look in the parts catalog for a 777, there is no fuel tank because the fuel tank is encased by other parts. It's a void, it's an empty space. So I love that. The hoaxsters love to jump on that and they are fools. Anyway, so the cooling air passage, it's compressor discharge air that leaks past the rear compressor seals. We're going to take a look at a diagram at this for this right now. The air passes through the turbine shaft, because it's quite large usually, and sometimes it's shaped more like a funnel or a cone, but the air goes through there, goes through passages that are between the turbine discs. And what we normally call, with the older engines, we would call it a spacer. There's a turbine disc, another turbine disc with the blades, and then a spacer in between there. Okay, folks, this is a book that I recommend. I don't recommend it all by itself. You can go in and search for that and buy it. If you need me to put a link somewhere for you to click on a link to buy it, you're helpless and I'm not interested in helping you. It's here it is, these guys. I recommend it. I'm not getting paid by them. This is not the best book in the world, and I don't recommend it being used solely by itself. As all textbooks, I recommend using several of them, all intersecting on the same subject. So we're going to be looking at one of these. This is the turbine rotor from the LM2500 and or CF6, which is a predecessor to the GE90. The GE90 probably looks a lot different than this, but it's similar. So what we've got is, in here, this space is where the combustors are. The fuel is burnt. So this is the back of the compressor case. And these two seals here, these knife edge seals, they keep compressor air from leaking away from the end of the compressor, which is very high pressure air. The more you can seal it and make it go this way and not leak everywhere, the better. But this part, this is a rotor, this has to turn, so it seals against the compressor case and air wants to leak out. So what they've done is they've put a hole here between the two seals, so it leaks past this seal a little bit, and then this seal resists it some more. Some of it gets wasted back into the combustion pathway, but this hole makes air go inside this beautifully shaped rotor, and the air can travel. This is a disc. This would be the spacer impeller. This is the spacer. This connects mechanically one disc to the other. And you can see that this is the inner hole in the compressor, or the turbine disc, and it's fat here to maintain strength around the hole so it doesn't fly apart. Here's another one. These are not attached to the shaft. They're attached to the shaft here. So this structure right there, this thin structure, that thin structure, this transmits all the mechanical torque to the shaft. There's no connection here. Anyway, air can leak in here. Air goes between holes in the spacer, leaks out here, and it would just leak out into the gas pathway because compressor discharge air is higher pressure than here because the burning of the fuel does not increase the pressure. It increases the speed of the gases blasting out. Pressure here is lower than there. This is the compressor. This is where the fuel is burnt. The pressure is lower here than there. I'm saying that over and over again because some people just can't get it. Anyway, so if it's leaking through here, it's going to leak that way. It's not going to leak in. It's going to leak out. This thermal shield, they call it. This is a thermal shield. This is what would be called an interstage seal. So the air comes up here and it's stopped there. Where's it going to go? It goes into the base of the blades and leaks out here. You can see a little arrow. I think there's a better diagram. Hang on. Oh, there we go. This is the diagram that you guys all want to see. Here we go. Let's zoom in a bit. This is awesome. We're going to be taking a look at a real one of these soon. When will the future be now? Soon. Cross-section of the high-pressure turbine. This is from a CF6, the predecessor to the GE90. These little arrows, see the air leaks in there, fills this space, leaks in there, leaks past there, comes up here, goes through those holes, and leaks out through the blades. So that's what we call cooling air. Now, funny that it's called cooling air because it is compressor discharge air, and that means it is about 1,000 degrees, let's say 800 to 900 degrees Fahrenheit. It's compressed air, very hot, but it's compressed air minus the fuel, because once you burn the fuel in that air, it gets to 3,000 degrees, and then the rest of the compressor discharge air mixes in through the combustor liners. There might be one out in the shop we're going to that you can see, but I've shown combustor liners before in lots of videos. So the CDP, or the cooling air, mixes with the burning air to make what I call working air, and that goes into the turbines, and that is hotter. In modern engines, that's hotter than the melting point of the metal. So how do you get around that? You ceramic coat the metal. The blades are usually ceramic coated so that it reduces the amount of air or heat going into the blade from the hot gases. And you blast CDP, which is 900 degrees, through the blades. 900 is well below their melting point. So they're exposed to super hot gases that will melt them in minutes or seconds. But they're being blasted with relatively cool air from the inside to keep them cool. If that interstage seal fails, you can see now that the source of the cooling air is compromised. The air will go through the hole. If there's a hole burnt or a crack, if a crack happens in the interstage seal, the air will blast out through there. Less cooling air goes through the blades. The temperature of the blade metal goes up, and then it's only a matter of time until the first one melts or lets go or something goes on. And then you have a cascade of disaster and things start to fly apart.
So Juan, in his video about this, he talks about the blade roots being cooled, but you can see from the structure of the blade that the cooling air comes in through the base of the root and exits through the airfoil surfaces. The whole blade is cooled with air that comes in through the root and comes out. So the whole thing is cooled. When that's compromised, especially with a modern engine, with an air-cooled blade, the blade will fail very quickly. And that's why this happened immediately after run-up. The seal may have already been cracked, so the engine will idle, it will run at moderate power, it can taxi around just fine, and then you put the blocks to it, give it full takeoff power. It was only a matter of seconds. They got to what, 55 knots, and it went. So that's, let's say that's less than 10 seconds of running at high power, and everything went to the graveyard. It went to the poop pile. And so in a way it's good that didn't happen after 5 minutes when they're up in the air. Anyway, take a look at my video called Air Cooled Blades, and we're gonna go driving in the snow and try to take a look at a CF6 rotor right now. We're so lucky to have one on the balance machine, so hang on.
Well, the best time to film what I was just about to show you would have been, let's see, today's Saturday, would have been Thursday. It's Saturday morning, and the turbine rotor that was on the balance machine, now it's in the tool that's required to install it in the engine, which is right here. Let me take that cover off and I'll show you. All right, so if we look down, these things are kind of flopping around, so they're unstable. Look down into the engine, there's a dust cap over the compressor rotor stub shaft. Let's just take a look. Okay, so that's hollow. I don't know if you can see some holes down in there, but there's holes for air transfer. These are those two seals. There's one there, one there. And this is the wall between this space and the combustion happens inside there. Combustor liner is in there. This is the first stage nozzle. So this is actually the hottest part of the engine, and it's air cooled as well. Okay, so the turbine disc or turbine shaft is going to go in there. Let's take a look at its structure. All right, here it is. We've got the this is where it connects to the compressor. There's those seals, and inside there we've got air traveling. Oh, there's a couple holes in there. Oh, there's a space in there. Okay, there's a space that goes up where my finger is. And okay, so the interstage seal is right here, and you might be asking rightly, if the interstage seal gets to the base of the blades and traps them in place, how do you get the blades in? Well, the interstage seal is between two discs on the, I guess, the rear side of the first stage and the front side of the second stage. And so the blades will come in from the outside, which is the front of the first stage, and from the rear of the second stage. I've got this backwards. This is the first stage, that's the second stage. Anyway, this is the front, so the blades slide in this way and butt up against this seal. And the second stage blades, they slide in from the rear and butt up against that seal. So this seal here, you can see it doesn't completely occlude or block off the complete root of the blade, but it seals off the disc to the base of the root, and that's where the air, cooling air comes in from. It slips around that little space. Can you see that? A little space there. Comes out that space into this little valley and then into the air-cooled blade. So it's a bit complicated. And like I said, there are no actual air cooling ducts. The cooling air travels between things that makes passageways. So it's very hard to show the passageway because it's all built into the engine, and it's in clearances and leakage pathways that the cooling air gets to the blades. And this is there's the exit holes of the cooling air of the air-cooled first stage blades. Super cool. So when you lose that cooling air, things go bad very quickly. Very, very quickly. And this whole arrangement here probably weighs about 250 kilograms and it spins in this engine at 9,200 RPM. So 9,200 RPM, 250 kilograms, that's a lot of kinetic energy to tear things up and to travel great distances at high velocities and break stuff and hurt people. Somebody also asked yesterday if the when the engine shuts off, is air or is oil pressure still supplied to the bearings? And the answer is yes, because this is connected to the engine. This is the accessory gearbox. There's a giant radial drive shaft that goes through there to an angle drive on the main rotor of the engine. As long as the main rotor of the engine is turning, so is this, which drives a bunch of gears, and that is the oil pump assembly. That's about 7 oil pumps all together, scavenging and pushing and pulling. That's a very expensive, very complicated oil pump. Very cool. So yes, there's always oil circulating if the engine is turning. If engines are turning, oil is pumping.
Okay, so for timely updates on aviation news, Blanco Lirio's channel is great. He usually has stuff up the same day or the next day. And so it's a very good no-nonsense channel. There's no bias, there's no, what am I trying to say? No stupidity. If you watch all the network news people talking about aviation or science, they're all idiots. They're all primarily broadcasters who are trying to seem like they know something, and they don't know anything. Which is why I was at first suspicious of this story, because when you say interstage seal, it means a lot of things to different people. It's a very specific part, and even in the FAA airworthiness directive, there's very, very few technical details, but we're pretty sure, because we thought about it independently, that that part that is called an interstage seal, or a thermal shield, is something that definitely could lead to the loss of a turbine disc or blade due to the loss of cooling air. So anyway, that's my little contribution to the knowledge, so that everybody has a background of what people are talking about, what things are, what it looks like, how it works, and how it could possibly have led to some sort of problem. I'm not saying that this is what happened. I'm not saying that, not even saying that that's exactly how the GE90 is built, but like I said, it's most likely everything's a little bit different shape, but it's all got the same function, and all these engines are the same and they're all different. The basic principles of how they work and the basic ways things are done are usually down along the same kind of lane of thinking. So anyway, I hope that helped, and I will put a link to Blanco Lirio's channel in the info section, and I will put a link to the full document. It's only 3 or 4 pages long, the full airworthiness, emergency airworthiness directive, is that what it's called? Anyway, there's a link there, you can read the whole thing. You'll see that it's 95% yakety yak, and the actual details of what happened to the engine is very, very short. Again, eight individual serial numbers, which makes me think that it could have been a batch of material, but since the serial numbers are all different, maybe it was when they were cranking up a machine or a process, the first few or the last few weren't so great, and then another set, the first few or the last few weren't so great, but like I said, there's only 8. So this means there's 8 engines out there that need this emergency directive. So it's a big story if you're flying on one of those planes, but overall it's not a big story. It's 8 individual engines. And how many GE90 115Bs are there out there? I don't know, hundreds. Hundreds of them. Anyway, from a snowy Saturday, it's actually 90, I'm gonna show you, the snow is at 90 degrees to the ground.
Okay, not quite 90, can you see the snow? Should we dare open the door? It's just going sideways. It's what they call sideways rain on Vancouver Island. There, I just shoveled that about a half hour ago. This. Anyway, that's the pathway to our friendly water jet cutter and fab shop. I'm gonna go home and I'm gonna ride my bike today. What's that you say? What sort of a bike are you gonna be riding today in a foot of snow? Why, this bike. The secret to that bike is 4-inch wide tires. Good ones. These ones. I'm not sponsored by these people either.
Oh, can you see it? Yeah, you can see that.
Not sponsored by them, but they make really good tires.
Super soft compound, 4 inches wide.
Ice and snow, no problem. Okay, so this bike is a Canadian bike called a Moose, and I'm not sponsored by them either. I just like the bike. Anyway, the tires are called Jumbo Jim. So yesterday, only yesterday, I came up with a name for my bike. I think the name of the bike is Large Marge. There's the summer bike over there. It's got 3.8 inch tires. This has got 4.8 inch tires. Sorry, not four, it's 4.8. Yeah, Large Marge, that's her new name. Riding Large Marge with Jumbo Jim. Yeah.
Thanks for watching.